Good evening, everyone, and thanks for being here with us today. Today marks the first TikTok, and with 52 people already joining in, we are very, very proud to host a wonderful and inspiring keynote speaker, Dr. Uli Waltinger. But before we get started, I'd like to express, of course, my gratitude to all my colleagues who make this event possible, especially to Madeleine and Janina, who make all of this happen, Sven and Christoph, and all the colleagues from the Institute who build, operate, and grow the Institute, and of course, everyone from EBS, which is a fantastic place where we want to empower you to shape the future. My name is Tobias Gutmann. I'm an assistant professor at EBS, and together with Sven Henkel and Christoph Schneider, who are also here with me today, we are building the TIC, and TIC is the new Institute for Technology, Innovation, and Customer Centricity. I'm also head of the Siemens Product Innovation Lab, which centers around how to build market-relevant products and services. And we partner with a lot of different organizations, but a big shout out goes to all my colleagues from Siemens Advanta Consulting, which is a management consultancy firm of Siemens, which is of course one of the world's most innovative engineering and technology companies. At the TIC, which I'm going to introduce to you now, we want to find answers to actually the great question of today's decision makers, innovators, and change makers in business and society. And so what we're trying to create is this internationally recognized platform for discourse between scholars and practitioners. And why we're doing this is we have three layers that I want to show to you. The first one is we see a lot of technologies. So we call it the enabling technologies. It's about AI, it's 3D printing, quantum computing, blockchain, and so on. So many, many interesting technologies where we ask ourselves the question, how does technology change business and society? And then one layer above, there is the people and organization layer, where there's industry, a lot of enterprises, organizations who are using and building technology. There's society, so people, you and me, who are also using this technology. And then there's academia, where we research the impact of the technology. And we not really see a successful and fruitful collaboration between those three stakeholders. And this is why we ask the questions, how can we build bridges between industry, academia, and society? And because we are a business school, we bring the third layer, which is management practice, with a lot of insights, methods, and an ecosystem, where we ask, how can we equip managers to, like the managers of today and of tomorrow, to successfully navigate the future? And this is why we established a TikTok, which today is the first one. And we want to invite inspiring personalities to promote technology-oriented innovation management practices to actually build these bridges that I'm just talking about. And today, I'm very proud to introduce to you Dr. Uli Waltinger. Uli, you are a researcher, you are the founder and technology head of the Siemens AI Lab. You're also head of the Machine Intelligence Research Group at Siemens Technology. You have a PhD in computer science, and Uli, I've been knowing you now for some years, and I love that you are really a visionary thinker and not just a splendid keynote speaker, that's why you are also here today, but you're also an inspiring leader with this hands-on attitude, which is very rare in big organizations. I think and I believe that you have this talent to bring together many different people with a lot of different backgrounds who really work on things that make a difference. And one of the things that make a difference is AI, and you have a keynote for us prepared with the title AI-Driven Business Models. So for everyone who's here today, we have a 15 minutes keynote, then we have a 15 minutes interview where I ask some questions to Uli, and later on, we also have 15 minute Q&A where you can ask your questions to Uli. So without further ado, Uli, the stage is yours, and welcome on board.
Thanks very much. That's a very charming introduction. Hey, guys, folks out there, thanks very much. I feel super excited and actually super honored that the premiere of the TikTok, right? In I'll be there. You should see my slide somehow, right? Is that if viewable?
Yes, we can see.
All right, awesome. So I'm super excited that you tune in here. It's 7 o'clock in the evening here, right, in Germany as well, right? And in terms of and in times of Clubhouse, right? Where, you know, you don't see anything, no video, right? Just audio, right? Thanks for chipping in here and giving it a shot, what TikTok, what Toby and his folks actually are, you know, are keen on. And when I heard EBS, right, I said, like, yeah, we need to talk about business, a bit of business models around there. And this is what I'm trying to do in the next, hopefully 15 minutes, maybe it's maybe 90 minutes, in talking about a bit, some perspectives from an industrial AI perspective. Here we go. Let's look in. So in first place, right, we're talking about what I call a data-driven society, right? I think we are in a current situation. If you drove to your workplace or you drove home, the likelihood that you were captured by some kinds of surveillance camera is very high, that you track your GPS data right along the line with your mobile phone is very high, that you interact with some kind of social media platform is very high, that some kinds of vehicle industrial flair, sensing environments have also perceived your activities is very high. And that gives us this kind of momentum, right? Where we say, like, actually, it's a great start, right? To play, you know, rethink places, to rethink products, to rethink maybe also AI or T, right? Join it together, make it a bit more better eventually, hopefully, right? I'm a geek by nature. If you drill it down, right? So like, hey, we live in data driven, you know, then that means actually it comes up with these formula, right? And these formula, for those, you know, a bit in the stats and the math, this is what I call a cost function, right? A cost function is something we need to optimize, especially in machine learning, right? So we either can, you know, reduce the loss basically, or we maximize the reward, right? And I guess the tricky question, especially also in business modality, is, right, how do we define values in these, you know, that we want to optimize in these technical and software-centric systems, right? And if you look in the, obviously, the social media rooms, right, this could be a photo of my kids, my daughters, right? Entirely throughout this pandemic in front of their screens, right? And we all somehow, obviously, you know, somehow feel addicted. And this is obviously also because a lot of business models, target towards, desirable behavior, attention, right? We're living in an economy of attention. We all have our 30 seconds attention span, you know, and platform business models using very smart tricks in capturing your 30 seconds attention span to refresh, basically, you know, keep on scrolling, keep on adding, keep on being engaged on value service so they can sell potentially more ads and so on, right? And if you put that obviously from the consumer space into the industrial space or the AI IoT space, right, then you may see from a corporate perspective two different streams what it's being fed in. On the one side, you have the outside in, which, you know, we arise on new technology, machine learning aspects, maybe, you know, additive manufacturing, maybe, you know, inverted guns, we have digital technologies and we want to digitize. And obviously what we talk today, a bit of business models attached, which, you know, which changes obviously the value focus. On the inside in, I know that's a weird thing, right? Weird expression. We can see three different streams in the broader ship when I hear about AI, artificial intelligence in general. On the one side, I would call it, we have digitalization on steroids. You know, we look at given processes and see what of these processes in the corporate are not yet digitized and can we lift up to a digital process. Second, automational steroids, right? Sometimes it doesn't have to be the magic, right, happening. Also not probably machine learning, but sometimes, you know, automating processes can get very effective and efficient in there, right? So we look at a given digitized process and see what is the weakest signal, what can be maybe automated and push more in efficiency in there. Third is correlation steroids. And that's obviously something, you know, predicted on machine learning aspects. Then we control some kinds of interval at some kinds of probabilities on two, like, is this a talk, is this an event, is it a sales forecast maybe, right? So we built some kind of forecasting and predictive models. And all of them go into then the fourth pillar, a data-driven decision support. And that means we wanna have, you know, not that decisions are made by gut feeling, which is also nice sometimes, right? But should be at least supplemented by data, by beta, by statistics. And to be honest and to be fair, that draws quite some uncertainty in corporates. It's, what do we need to learn? What kind of skills do we need, right? Do I need to learn more Python, right? What kind of business models are now when ecosystems, partners, you know, jointly go up on and have some kinds of competition, right? What is an RPA and RDA? Is that something that replaces me or some of the tasks? All these different streams that we see, you know, are changing not only the processes we have, but it also they generate enormous uncertainty. And uncertainty is under every CEO's bat, as they call it, right? The stall from the Wall Street Journal. And if I think on this uncertainty, then I reflect on Keith Jarrett. I don't know if you remember the concert or at least have heard about that, because that's for me, whenever I, you know, think on uncertainty, I think on the beauty of imperfection. And the beauty of imperfection on Cologne concert was that the Keith Jarrett concert in Cologne was organized by a 17-year-old girl, the youngest concert maker actually in the race in Germany, right? And she organized a piano totally mistuned, right? Pedals not working. So Keith Jarrett, star in jazz, right, on the piano, arrived at the very concert hall, tested the piano and identified nothing will work out. Nothing will tune as it should be because, you know, mistuned pianos. What he did was he basically improvised an entire 2.5 hour concert, which was sold then 3.5 million times and was the concert itself. And that shows that, you know, these kinds of uncertainty that we embrace, right? They don't follow just out of the box in there. Also improvising over a good skill set is not something that's followed out of the box here. It follows a operating model. And in terms of these structured, you know, process that we have and these fields of uncertainty that we feel, right? I think, you know, it's important to have not a nailed down casing in the operating module, but at least a couple of systematic aspects towards a, you know, how do we assess use cases? How do we organize ourselves? How do we talk to talent? And how do we perceive also on technology side? And I would like, you know, to guide you through for the next 10 minutes a bit of how do we maybe, you know, adjust on the successful execution of these AI agenda. On the one side, technology, right? Most journeys in which I have received or seen or expired or experienced this, right, in enterprise AI aspects, you can differentiate between a bit larger and smaller companies. Smaller companies rather struggle with, you know, what is the vision and what is the strategy approaching that with AI? While larger companies, maybe I'm in there as well, right, struggle rather on the end-to-end going solution. So getting end-to-end, it's actually deployed at the very end. And then you have the adoption layer of the machine learning capabilities, where the usual journey starts, you know, you test it out, you try it out, you explore the capabilities, you start with a working student, right? Working students actually, you know, drive, are the actual CTOs, I guess, or CDOs, right, in large corporation. Then you start up with, you know, with external consultants, then you grow your internal capabilities, a bit of team size 5 to, let's say, 15. But in the end, it's still struggling that most of the companies, like 90%, right, of you know, grown out capabilities aren't yet deployed on productive system, right? And it's great work actually from Algorithmia, kudos to Diego. And there's many reasons, and there are different reasons why these, you know, not happening, why these value pools are not happening. Because I think on the one side, it's, you know, the typical proof of concept thing, right? So in larger corporates, it may be easier in the last 4 years to, you know, get some kind of budget for POC. But in fact, most of the POC budgets come not from the product-centric funding, but more from the transformation, digital transformation funding. That means CEOs, CXOs see it rather as a training than at generating and extracting values out of the process. The second aspect is, you know, yeah, we got this working students, right? Which has DevOps, UI, UX, ML, AI, and engineering experience, right? This ain't gonna work out, right? So you need to think about what's the right partnering solution. A third pillar is obviously, you know, if you develop certain capabilities, right, you will always find proprietary systems, right? And you need to be somehow able to tightly integrate, but loosely couple it so you can, you know, adjust to the in-house technology. And fourth, obviously, you know, if your project doesn't have an executive sponsor, it will be the Daskus. No doubt about it. It will be the Daskus. So that means there is actually a clear aspect how to approach it, so you're not falling back in the proof of concept phase. And if you look down on the value chain, then you see like each startup or in each company I've seen, like they're trying to shape these competences around a platform. They want to build a platform because somebody said like platform is a great moneymaker. But in fact, if you observe a bit of the differentiation between, you know, where the sources of value that it comes from, then you will see that, you know, a large extent is obviously not entirely on the platform itself, but on the service and solution you put on top of your platform. These are actually the revenue maker where the actual value arises. As well as, not to forget, hardware is still sexy, right? Hardware is still sexy. So I guess if you guys have a startup out there, you want to attach, right, a nice service and solution on top of, yeah, a third party platform, you know, make use, because platform is a zero money business. It's just how out of invest, right? And venture capitalists don't like that too much, right? Having some hardware attached to that. And obviously, if we look now a bit further from an industrial perspective, we see two trends, right? Two somehow disparate trends, right? In the age of AI, IoT, right? On the one side, you have this connected people aspect in there, right? Where we're trying to get companions out there, decision support systems out there, right? And on the other side, the growth of the connected machinery, right? So expected to be doubling up, right, until 25. And what we see on the connected human side, obviously, you know, there will be light rising, right? But obviously the machines, you know, connecting machines to each other will be super planned. And the growth in that is super interesting for me and for us, right? On the other side, obviously, I've heard that before, right? Connected machines, right? And it's a great, I guess, connection, like the expectation, right? When there's 50 billion connected devices, here the stats show human and machines, basically, are rising, right? It's 2018 should have been 50 billion. Obviously, reality looks different, right? And I always refer to Andrew's nice Twitter meme, right? IoT is actually when your toaster mines Bitcoin to pay off its gambling debts to the fridge, right? I don't want to have this energy bill, to be honest, if my toaster now starts to mine Bitcoin. But it clearly shows the aspirations that you want to have, actually, right? The aspirations that machine-to-machine communication accelerates significantly. With that, the opportunities in business. And I would even say, right, there's another, sorry, geeky, another form for, you know, emerging AI, IoT in the field. It's not only the AI and machine learning making, you know, data work, making not IoT only, making machines compute, right? But also encompass that with the user experience, you know, that needs to be surrounded by an attractive business model. So this is what I think is the, you know, the formula of, you know, towards a more AIoT centric mindset. And that means obviously AI and IoT means like physical digital work, right? This is something very natural, obviously, to a large industry conglomerate, right? Which brings then, and this is the only use case there, you know, different use cases around, whether it's dev, whether it's edge, whether it's cloud. We're talking about, you know, when when, I don't know, grids are actually digitized, when we put simulation together with sensor information, when we put more adjustability and independence in robotic movement systems on a controller level, or obviously if we're using, you know, computer vision modalities in improving additive manufacturing printing, right? And in a broader sense, if we zoom out a bit again, then we can see two different trends. One is called the enterprise AI. The second one is called industrial AI. The enterprise AI focuses rather on the depth of value, process automation, right? Analytics-driven accounting, IT, hiring, retention, general management, churn reduction, you name it, fraud detection, these kinds of use cases. The industrial AI perspective targets more, you know, the physical and virtual world in that. The asset indexing, monitoring, data management, predictive maintenance, for sure, right? These kinds of aspects. And the interesting aspects, the pure moneymaker, will be in the intersection of both when human data and machine data join in forces, right? And obviously, a rising business model is still quite so wild in the hip, but I think we still will see hopefully a lot of innovation spinning around about the digital twins of everything, basically, right? The product, the production, the performance, the system, the patient, the building, the supply chain, you name it, right? There needs to be a virtual representation and a model, right? A plethora actually of models, right? Of some kind of physical entity and or process in order to simulate more and leverage digital capabilities on top of the given representation. Fourth pillar is obviously data. And data, if you look in the current hips, right, data threadiness is still horrible in most of the cases, right? So the question is, you know, how mature is an organization in accessing, delivering, sharing, utilizing, you know, data sets? Do we have the right legal in place? Do we have the tools in place? Do we have the right processes there, right? And data accessing means, like, you know, not saying, yeah, there needs to be some ERP system somewhere, but actually being able to leverage your own data. And I think this will give still a quite a high business model around new enablement of organization towards their business strategy. And then obviously happens throughout the comprehensively, right? Some use cases all around the globe, actually, and all around the corporate process, from sales to financials, from security to mobility, right? From insurance to manufacturing. There's humongous and nice use case templates existing. One of you where you want to dive into is the applied AI use case collection, which is also already super nice being visualized on which different levels actually AI adds value to the corporation. And on which level it adds value, I think, you know, we moved it away. I'm sick of, to be honest, on this proof of concept thing, because it's not about proving whether AI adds value to something. It's rather, do you have the breadth and the power to go end to end? And do you have the breadth and power in identifying what is called the minimal justifiable improvement? Is it the right problem? What kind of problem needs to increase? What kind of percentage needs to go up 1% that you get your bonus, right? This is the first question to ask. Why are we doing that? The second one is how? And that means, do we know which process to change in order to unlock this value? And this is the process. It's not a technology. It's not a talent. It's not anything. It's just, you know, where does it need to change and trigger in the process? Where it needs to be integrated? And then the third is, you know, do we get this data feedback? Do we get, you know, the source information out there? And fourth, do we somehow enable the convenient user interface? A convenient user interface, a user experience, if the button is not there, if the lamp is not lightning, if the threshold is not, you know, somehow being triggered, right? A user experience is super important in order to increase the convenience on the value added service. And this comes to the other aspects that a lot of innovation in industrial AI, or in AI especially, was about the AI capabilities. A plethora of startups and also, you know, grown up corporates said, like, yeah, we have this nice technology, right? And maybe the dive towards, you know, the business process integration is right. I know, I think where it needs to be integrated, right? But in current times, you need to think about entirely end-to-end. And that means not only growing the AI capabilities, but also thinking about how to automate these capabilities in a productive system, MLOps, DevOps, right? And if MLOps, you know, trigger automatically business process integration, this requires some trust, not only understanding of the problem, but also automation and trust itself. And that brings down to the aspects of how do we execute it in an organization? I must admit, I love the Alex perspective on explore exploits. And I think especially large corporations can really profit from this differentiation between, you know, what it means on exploration, right? Being fast, being on prepper and explore as incentivized, and the exploitation actually, right? Where you, the usual business KPI you can assess it, which is rather more software development and software engineering and operational centric. And given the momentum you can speed up in the explore phase, right? Different skill sets need to be attached as well as to the exploit area where you're then hardening the process and rather see it from a software engineering perspective. And so that brings me, I don't know, 20 minutes after, right? It's impact stories are obviously, you know, it's most easy to prototype things, right? But I think we are way above the level of whether AI adds some value. So you need to think about end-to-end cases, and even if it's only, you know, one capabilities you ship continuously. Second aspect, business driven, right? Especially SMEs try hard on, you know, what's the business driven innovation in their perspective. You need to guide them and consult them on the way, you know, using and leveraging your partners out there for technology or for business. And third pillar is it's still trust as we accelerate, you know, uncertainty and as we accelerate the impact of digital technologies. Trust and security will become even more important. And with that, thanks very much that I could join in here, and I'm looking forward to discuss with you together.
Thank you, Uli. Virtual applause to you. Really rich insights. I really enjoyed it. And I now have thousands of questions. Unfortunately, we don't have so much time to go through all of the questions. But can you maybe share, what is the Siemens AI Lab? We haven't talked about the Siemens AI Lab, but can you share some insight about what it is and how you drive AI-driven business models there?
All right. So the Siemens AI Lab, so the lab, we started like 3.5 years or 4 years ago. And the question is, how do we guide now the journey towards maybe towards an AI-driven enterprise or an AI-first company, right? And so we traditionally started as like, let's connect not only the what we do, what kind of use cases we enable, with the how we want to do things. Because culture and interaction within teams is a key ingredient in order to boost innovation. And that's why we gave it these two different sides of dimension at the Siemens AI Lab. One is aspects, how can we accelerate the fails in corporate innovative ideas? And how can we multiply an open, bold, and committed culture interacting with each other? And that's why we started with inviting, you know, colleagues throughout the corporation, and this company where I work for has quite some lot of people and businesses, and facilitating that. And we invite with, you know, ideas, and once we made this platform as a physical platform, people can go there, right? A bit outside, right? Can go out there and focus on you know, without distractions of daily obligations. Then a lot of cases came, right? It's like, hey, what about a chatbot? Hey, what about a chatbot? Hey, what about a chatbot, right? And maybe others as well, right? And this is where we identified, actually, you know, we need to challenge these kinds of aspects. So why do you want to build a chatbot? Yeah, because it's cool. It can answer everything question. Or why do you want to do an autonomous robot there, right? Mm-hmm. And this is where we identified then individual working streams, which is like, we need to challenge and but also guide somehow the journey, given different, you know, stakeholders that we have, sometimes it's, you know, it's the manager and said like, hey, what does AI to my job? Right? Sometimes it's HR and said like, what for an impact will have RPAs on our workforce, right? Sometimes it's an innovator from an industry and says like, hey, does machine learning add something to it? And this is where we structure and help in a very fast-paced environment, to be honest, right? We call it 5 days to fail in terms of, you know, coding sprints that we do together in order facilitating these kinds of journeys. And since then, we adopt it continuously, to be honest, right? Because don't stay static, adapt to uncertain. And that's why we changed it also over the last years, and especially in like the last 1.5 years, maybe, right? We got a lot of questions also, not only from internal, but they're like, hey, you've seen all these abstracted use cases and projects. Let's talk also from external. And that's quite nice. This is this open innovation culture, which we love to shape.
There are already so many nuggets like in your answer. You mentioned the point of culture. You also had this cool example with this improvised concert, which I really enjoyed. Can you like give some advice on how can corporates, or how do you at Siemens establish a culture of improvisation?
Yeah, that's super tricky, right? But actually, I would quote Astrotella and say like, it's easy, don't be a jerk, right? I love that. Astrotella has the Google X, right? And I think that is something very challenging and the most challenge, right? It's people love creative ideas, but reject it, right? Because we are living in a complex world, and in a complex world, we demand more and more simplification and coming up with out-of-the-box thinking. Not every idea is great, right? Maybe sometimes, right? People tend to reject that. And I think one of the ingredients of these shaping teams on that is safety, to be honest. Mm. It's safety. Personal safety is like adding on the one side a secure zone where it's like, you know, fail is okay. I know it's simple, right? But it's simple, sad, but tough to be executed. The second one is meaning, right? Are we working on something that matters, right? And this is also not always the case, right? Which need to be actually be defined. And the third purpose is purpose, I would say. The third aspect is purpose. And I know purpose is a bit of whitewashing, right? A lot of whitewashing going there, but I think there is some really, really, really truth on that, on the purpose. I mean, really believe that we can change something, that we have an impact on something. And by far, I would say psychological safety is, you know, the most important. And especially large corporation, which sometimes, you know, teams are mixtured between, it's also fourth, it's not important who is on a team, but it's important how they interact. So you need to focus on the culture of interaction, you know, how these people exchange and how to motivate them that they exchange more, right?
Yeah. But very, very interesting. Well, I have so many questions. I think two more with regards to the time. There's this famous saying from Andrew Ng, which we learned in the that in the internet era, there was a shopping mall plus a website doesn't equal to an internet company. And now we find that any typical company plus deep learning technology will not equal an AI company. And you also mentioned this notion of AI first. What do you think of this like quote, and how can companies become AI companies?
I think there are many ways or maturity models, to be honest, from Gartner to whatsoever, right? What's the definition of AI first company? I think
an AI company. Does Siemens need to become an AI company?
Sure, right? Well, we're on the path, we're on a good track. Siemens is a large corporation, right? And that's why, you know, you have different aspects in the that you in general, right? There are certain digital maturity levels in certain businesses, right? In services, but I think we are on a really good track on there, and that means, but also like a comprehensive, you know, uses of data-driven business models. You need to enable that as well, right? It's guiding, obviously, it's training, it's awareness, it's maybe also reflecting on ethic guidelines, right? Because if you're convinced that this makes an impact on each product, each process, it has an impact, right? That means we need to talk also about, you know, the responsibilities of youth there. And I think this is something, you know, where you mature as an organization. And after maybe after the first, let's say, 100 proof of concepts, you execute it and implement it, right? You start making a systematic and pervasive use of these technologies, whether it's deep learning or machine learning, whether it's data science, data analytics, advanced analytics, a bit of forecasting, stuff like that. You will see that it has each individual impact on the process or the products, and also on the peoples. And this is what you see the initiatives that's being then launched, right? And a good start is obviously a COE, right? Center of competences, which top level execution, right? This top level support is already a good start, right? And then you can enable, you know, it throughout the entire organization. Mm.
Well, also thanks that you tailor made this presentation to the business side of things. We are business schools, so what kind of advice can you give our students who have, of course, a business background?
So you need to understand both worlds, to be honest, right? I know if you're business, fair enough, but you need to identify then also IT and OT world, right? We are on the living, the growth opportunity in the AI, IoT world, right? Connected machines. Is on the convergence between, you know, physical and virtual world, whether it's Siemens or not. You will see that this will be the opportunity. And if you want to go in these opportunities, you need to understand both worlds, OT and IT domain, right? And that means you need to also leverage a bit of domain know-how on the process itself, and as well as on the IT knowledge. To give you examples, you know, the last 3 years, I've seen a plethora of pitches of startups. Right? Where they're like, we have this technology platform that enables all kind of values, right? And I said, like, but what kind of value? Yeah, it's a computer vision platform. And it's for what computer vision? Yeah, everything. You can, you know, train your computer vision. It can be dogs, but it can be also something that you have, right? This is not enough, to be fair. New entrepreneurs and maybe future entrepreneurs as you are, or you already, right? Need to own more of the vertical, not of the horizontal, right? You need to own more of the vertical process. You need to be closer to the problems and own part of the process of a given problem, right? And I love the approach the Merantics guys have actually in Berlin with the two postdocs phenomenon, right? One CTO level, one CEO level. Means, you know, you have one expertise, deep knowledge in the IT and the technology around, and one, you know, postdoc in terms of the process and the operations of these works. And only if both fits together, right? Knowing about the value chain, the value pool, right? And the technology, how to enable it, that gives a leap. And this is what you also need to know. You need to understand both sides of